Bust crack-a-lack, and it's your boy Broshmo. Just in case you did not know, so we're here to talk about the top quarterbacks in the 2020 NFL draft. We're ranking them. I'm giving you 20 on average in the last 5 years. Only 11 quarterbacks are drafted in the NFL draft, but I'm giving you 20, so a lot of undrafted free agents here. And I imagine you want to see some, there's a lot of names people want to kind of talk about. I got a mock draft coming out Tuesday, so be on the look for that. And after the holidays basically wrap up here, expect some more content coming to the channel. Family will be out of town, that'll be great. But I'm gonna do some stuff with free agency. We're gonna take a look at the draft classes for teams and how they looked, how they did. We got a lot of stuff coming, so a lot of reason to be excited. So come bro and subscribe, and be sure to hit the thumbs up if you enjoy the content. It really helps out, helps this video get discovered, and it allows me to devote a little more time to content like this. So let's go ahead, let's look at 20 through 11 or 11 through 20. Let's start with some guys you notice aren't gonna be on the list. I got Cole McDonald out of Hawaii. I'm pretty sure he's gonna be staying. He's a junior. He's got a great arm. Very poor decision making. If you watch that bowl game against BYU, he was even pulled for a drive because that team just went cold, and he was kind of the reason behind it. So I expect him to return. Tyler Johnson from UAB, another guy with great arm strength. The dude drops dimes down the field, but he'd be throwing pennies everywhere else. It's kind of funny because it's changed. But another guy who's actually going to be playing Thursday. Game's not on. Game's about to come on. But it's Mike Glass from Eastern Michigan. I think he has a great opportunity. He's got good arm strength. He's got a legit arm. He's got good arm strength. And this bowl game against Pitt will be very indicative to if he is draftable or if he's going to be one of those undrafted free agents. So, yeah, the bowl game, like I said, it happens Thursday. This comes out Friday. I'm recording it before that, so who knows how he does. Arizona's Khalil Tate and Virginia's Bryce Perkins I didn't include on this list because they're not going to be quarterbacks at the next level. So let's go ahead and talk about these guys I have. We're going to start with Ian Brooks from Notre Dame. He's going to be a name you're going to see on a 90-man roster. I don't know if he's going to be much more than that. He's got limited arm talent, and he's a turnover waiting to happen. Despite his touchdown to interception ratio, he has a lot of turnover worthy plays, and the guy panics in the pocket. He's taken a lot of pressure and sacks just because he just doesn't have pocket presence. So he forces a lot of that himself. So I don't know how well I don't think he's going to be able to make a roster, maybe a practice squad. And then Mason Fine, the guy's got a great arm. His size ain't so great, and he's kind of had a rough year there at Northern Michigan. Also, he lost his top target week two or week three, Rico Bussey Jr. Steve Montez from Colorado, he looks the part. For all intents and purposes, he looks the part. He's got a cannon for an arm, but I don't think he has the instincts. Like, he looks the part, but he certainly doesn't play the part. I mean, he got to play with LaVisca Chenault Jr. and still didn't really provide much. Think you're kind of in that maybe career backup territory, and actually a lot of these guys are probably career backups. Definitely 15 through 20 are career backups. And then Nate Stanley, he plays in a pro style offense there at Iowa. That's about the only good thing you could say about him. I talked about him earlier in the year saying he really needed a big year to prove because he's got a high ceiling, but he didn't really do anything with that. Like I said, career backup. Jay Patterson from Michigan, very intelligent. He's going to interview extremely well at the combine. But his accuracy, man, like his accuracy, it drops after like passes beyond the line of scrimmage. So no screens or bubble plays. It drops to 45%. It's kind of alarming. So again, a guy that he has the potential there, but hasn't really done anything with it. Charlie Brewer, Baylor, he leaves much to be desired. His arm has very real limitations. He's a candidate to probably stay. And then we get into the guys that I think are draftable here. Sam Ellinger, the guy, short to intermediate accuracy. Bam, it's beautiful. But he doesn't like to play in the pocket. He has 61 scrambles on the year on pass plays. So a bit alarming. So that's why you see him here at 14. And then we got a very popular name for people. I think it's more so just because where he plays. He doesn't play at a high-profile school. Is James Morgan from Florida International. I think this is another guy, career backup type territory. He's got good size at 6'4", 213. He's got a rocket for an arm, but his accuracy. The guy, he dropped from 26 touchdowns last year, 214. He threw the ball more, and he ended up with a worse completion percentage. I mean, just looking at what the year season before, it was at 65%, and it dropped to 58% this season. So that is very alarming. So again, guy with a cannon for an arm, but he lacks accuracy. That's why you see him at 13. He's definitely one of those late day, day three picks. And then Kellen Mond, I'm sold on him coming back. So I'm not going to really dive into him. He kind of has had an up and down season. Anthony Gordon, a lot of people are real high on, but he doesn't throw the ball well downfield. He's kind of like Eason from Washington. He's very poor under pressure. His arm is kind of reminiscent of Gardner Minshew. It's not great arm talent, but it's something you could definitely work with. So that's why he's probably going to be a late day three pick. And then on to 10 through 1 or 1 through 10. We got Tyler Huntley starting the list off from Utah. He's got great arm. He's got great accuracy. My question, he's not that great of a decision maker. Not great, not necessarily a terrible decision maker, but it's his indecisiveness. He's third as far as how long he holds onto the ball after the snap. So the guy holds onto the ball for a long time. And then how poor his offensive line has played, that's kind of alarming. So granted, kind of got to take into consideration circumstance because, yeah, you're going to be indecisive the minute like you hike the ball and you got pressure in your face. But his lack lack of being able to make a decision in general kind of concerns me. But he's in the top 10. He's definitely droppable. For me, day three. And then KJ Costello, we talked a lot about him this year. He's got great size, great arm. Terrible decision maker, kind of the theme of this list. And then, very divisive pick here is Jalen Hurns coming in at 8. A lot of people, you're either in love with Jalen Hurns or you're not. And I happen to be just among those guys that really isn't. You got to look at everything. The guy's got a great arm. I'll give you that. But a lot of the passes he has made are, because he has got a great completion percentage. But he's throwing a lot of screens, throwing a lot of deep balls with guys that have like 3 yards of separation. CeeDee Lamb, he plays with CeeDee Lamb, mind you. So you don't necessarily need accuracy. You got to just chuck it down there and have your guy run under it. So there's concerns there. There are concerns. You got to look at the good and look at the bad. I don't think he's as prolific runner as like a Cam Newton or a... Lamar Jackson. There we go. Couldn't think of his name for a second. I don't think he's going to be as prolific as a runner. And that offense he's running there, Riley Lincoln, he's made it very friendly. It's very cool. His offense, his system's always been quarterback friendly. But with him, he's asked to go either through one or two progressions. And if it ain't there, then immediately run the ball. So he's not asked to do a ton there. So I get it. If you're really high on Jalen Hurts, he's a great prospect, but there's a lot of question marks. So you got to understand that as well. I got him in that third round discussion. I think that's a good place for him. For me personally, I think that's a good place. Then I got Jamie Newman, a guy I think he's going to return. The arm talent is there. He's got great arm talent. The guy throws a beautiful deep ball. He can throw his guys open at some points. There does need to be some stuff he needs to work on with that. But I think he's returning. I am so sold on him returning because we've already seen Carlos Basham on the defensive side for Wake Forest coming back. We see Sage Surratt. He's going to come back. So I think he's going to come back, and that's going to be a very dangerous Wake Forest team in the ACC. And then Jake Fromm here. at 6. And yes, it looks like he's taking a tumble, but it's because the guys above him, I think, have way higher upside. You know what we're getting with Fromm. Even if Fromm, I don't think there's no reason for Fromm to return. We know what he is. He's a game manager. He's got a limited arm, but he doesn't make bad decisions. He doesn't. He's a quick decision maker. He's really good at he's a game manager in general. It's just, he is the textbook definition of game manager. I still think his upside's Alex Smith, which isn't bad, but it should, that is a day two type of quarterback. So Fromm, probably one of the safer choices in this draft. And then I've bumped Jordan Love, and honestly I could bump him up even higher, and it is solely based on potential, because he looked terrible this year. He threw 17 interceptions, I believe, and his potential, I think, might carry him into the first round. I mean, I think if you're, and this might come into play in my draft, if you're a team that has an established starter and you could take a shot, like an older starter, maybe like the Saints or even the Patriots, and you could take a shot on a guy, maybe develop him for a year or two, I think that's probably ideal for Jordan Love, because I won't doubt the potential. There's a lot of things, a lot of tools to like about Jordan Love. It's just, he just didn't play it. He had a lot going against him there at Utah State. I really wish he would have came back, transferred, maybe to like Texas Tech, where his coach is, his former coach, or Oklahoma. So, I mean, there was a lot. He declared. I have him here at 5. He could jump Eason if Eason doesn't declare. I mean, with Eason, I mean, the dude's probably got the best arm talent in this draft, and that's including Justin Herbert. The guy's that good. He's just been terrible under pressure. Talked about it earlier in the video with, with who? Who did I talk about that with? It's irrelevant. It's irrelevant who I talked about it with. I think it was, it's irrelevant, you know. We're too far. Let's keep going with Eason. The guy, on his arm talent alone, probably going to be first-round pick, later first-round pick, but it is kind of alarming that when under pressure, like, he becomes a different quarterback, like half of what he is, you know? And then I got Herbert. Yes, I have Herbert under Tua. It was Anthony Gordon who I was thinking about. Pac-12 guys, man. But Herbert's got a great arm, just like Eason. But what ultimately I think what it is with Herbert is the reason he returned, the questions we wanted answered, you know, his disappearance act, his Houdini acts, so to speak, he didn't really quell any of those concerns. Like, honestly, his most impressive film this season has been the first half of that Auburn game and then that Washington game. Outside of that, it's been kind of either what you expected or what the heck, where'd he go? What happened? Like Utah, they didn't, in that Utah game, granted, they didn't need him, but they basically game planned him out of it. They focused on, we're gonna force a lot of turnovers on defense, and we're gonna run the ball down their throats. And that's what they did. So a lot of question marks with Herbert. And that's why I still got Tua. I know we don't know what's going on with the hip. I know he's had injuries in the past. People say he's made of glass. Look at that. Hashtag bars. I'm rhyming out here. But the talent's there, man. The guy is extremely accurate at the deep ball and the intermediate levels. You're going to have a little better ball placement in the intermediate levels. But still, he's been overall a great decision maker. You might be like, well, look at like almost 70% of his yards this season came after the catch, which isn't a great stat, but I mean, that's what haven't really had anyone on schedule. Like, look at the games where he had to come out and he had to perform. That LSU game, he balled out. He put his team in a position to win that game. So I still like Tua. We won't know for another month or two how everything checks out with the hip. Either pro Tua or you're anti-Tua. It is what it is at that point. If he gets a clean bill of health, then I'm okay with Tua here at number 2. And then Joe Burrow, man. We all know he's the best quarterback in this draft. The guy is amazing. He's got the most accurate quarterback from 10 yards or more. He's literally played himself into being the first overall pick in this draft. He's phenomenal. He's not a one-year wonder. He showed flashes last season, but what really brought him to this stage was Brady's offense, man. It was just... But that's it for the video. Go ahead, vote. You'll see it in the community tab. Vote for what you want to see me rank next. And remember about that mock draft coming out Tuesday. But until next time, you be easy, my friends. Later.